afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. I'm Bonnie Bully. I hope you had an amazing weekend. Today in The Loft, we're tackling an issue that's been at the center of debate on South Africa for some time now, natural hair. And for that, we've invited one of South Africa's biggest acting heavyweights, Florence Masebe. We also catch up with Professor Dlova from the University of KZN to just pick her brain on the issue. We also invite a young mother who's an entrepreneur who's designed swimming caps that are specifically made for African hair. But I'm not alone in The Loft today. I'm joined by my girl, Ayyanda Dlamini.
Oh, yay! And a big thank you to Bonnie. Good afternoon, South Africa. So happy to be in the kitchen. So join us in that conversation. It's a bit of a hairy situation, but you're welcome to have your say on social media. We'll give you those deets. But we are in the kitchen, and I'm not alone. His name is Dlephu from Woolworths. You are the product developer.
That is correct.
So what are we actually getting up to this afternoon?
Today, two simple things. We're going to be showing you how to cook the perfect steak. And we'll just be pairing that with just a little light pesto and a little green salad just to actually enjoy your Monday dinner.
All right, so a good steak, a delicious, juicy one.
Perfectly cooked
steak. The perfect.
Steak.
Of course, there'd probably be quite a few people who have a thing to say about
for
that
sure.
one. But I'm looking forward to those tips.
Yeah.
I definitely am. All right, so we're back to the lounge now, and we're going to find out from Bonnie. She's been talking about hair. So is it going to be a hairy situation? We'll find out some more.
Thank you, Ayyanda. Now, Florence Masebe has graced our screens for more than 20 years, and she's featured in some of South Africa's best love programs, Generations, Muvango, Seven Laan, Soul City. She's done it all. We're very privileged to have her in our loft today for her very first visit. Welcome, Florence.
Thank you.
Wow. This is a long overdue conversation.
I'm scared. I'm on TV.
What inspired your love for acting, and where did it all begin?
Do not really remember what it was, but at some point, I remember watching an illegal video recording of Woza Albert and getting totally moved by it. And then later getting an opportunity to watch My Children, My Africa at the Market Theatre. Uh-huh. And those things just ignited a fire in me where I just wanted to be one of those people who can do that. And I thought, okay, drama school.
Wow. And what was that experience like?
The drama school experience was crazy because when I got to drama school as a very, very young rural girl, I went literally straight from the northernmost parts uh-huh. of the country to the southernmost tip of the continent.
So it was a culture shock.
It was a culture shock and a half. I spent half my life just doing this all over Cape Town and, you know, missing home, missing village things, and yeah. there were none of those.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, there's a moment in every actress's journey or actor's journey where you're doing the acting thing, you're doing it, and then one day you play a role and you're like, I'm an actress. I had that moment. And have you had a moment like that where you were just like, this is it, I know that I am this?
I've had quite a few of those moments over the years while working. But I think the one time when I knew I've reached a point of no return was after I did Ererwani. Because for the first time, I had an opportunity to represent who Florence is
wow.
in a role that wasn't necessarily Florence, but it was a story that had been yearning to be told, and I went for it. And it changed me and changed my outlook on how I choose the jobs that must come my way. I'm at a point now when I can say, if it's not resonating with Florence, I'd rather not do it. I'd rather wait and write another role that's going to touch me
wow.
as well as Ererwani did.
Wow, and that's quite a sacrifice to make. I mean, how did you solve that dilemma? Was there a time when you just felt like you had to just take every role that came your way?
Look, when I was a younger actor, you take whatever your agent sends you to. So you do things. And for the longest time, I was just taking roles. I was taking roles because the character seemed cool, and I got up and I did it. And I'm multilingual, so I speak everybody else's language in everything I do. But I had never truly got an opportunity to do a beautiful piece for myself and my people in my own language.
Yeah, yeah. Ererwani is truly a beautiful piece, and what an outstanding performance. Tell us about the journey of making that film and some of the obstacles that you came up against.
Do you know, when the director, Nchabinwa Ruri, master of note, when he approached me to do Ererwani, I think I was 28.
Really?
And I said, yay, I remember the book. I read it in high school. Please make the film. And the guy never came back to me, and I got so angry, I figured he went with someone else.
Right.
Then, just before my 37th birthday,
what?
He phones and says,
I think we're ready to make that film.
And what was the first thought that came to mind?
You're mad.
I can't play at 23-year-old. There's no way. I'm not going to do it.
And I thought you did it quite well.
He said, no, you're going to do it. Oh, and the work it took. But it was beautiful. And then, you know, the challenges of running out of money and then, you know, getting involved behind the scenes and in actually the producing and creating of the of the film as well. You then learn all the hardships of what it takes to get a film in this country
made. It's a miracle.
From script.
Making a film anyway is a miracle.
No, actually. In South Africa, it's not a miracle. It's madness. you have to have a little bit of illness in your head for you to be willing to make South African films. It's that hard.
Interestingly enough, for me, I see so many parallels between Elirani and yourself in terms of just her transformation in the film, which brings me now back to the hair story.
Oh, the hair story. You know, I've always been, if you really go back to the work I've always done, I hid myself with either being the braids girl or the girl that went into, when Erykah Badu was influencing all of us, I went into the head wrap era as well.
Okay.
Because I always had to do something to keep my hair away from being burnt on set. Because when you arrived...
Or mistreated in some way.
Mistreated, because I always arrived with an afro. And when you arrived with an afro, the first thing they did was to heat up the hot rollers and the hot comb and the hot everything so that they can straighten the kink out of your hair. So everybody always had something to do to your hair before you even had an opinion on whether you wanted it done or not.
Right.
When you're still starting out, you don't have a say, Bonnie. They want you with straight hair. They want you with beautiful curls. So if it means they're going to perm your hair, curl your hair, they're going to do that. And at some point, it was even about the money that comes with it. Hmm. You know, Lord knows, I was paid by a hair
brand
as well.
And at that time, you're not thinking too hard about what it's going to look like. It's neither here nor there.
Even as they're doing your hair, you're crying. You know it hurts every time they relax your hair. Yeah. I don't know anybody who enjoys having their hair relaxed.
Yeah.
You know, but you just go with it. But the truth is, I have never really loved straight hair.
Right.
I don't want it.
Yeah, it holds no appeal for you.
It's really... I don't feel more beautiful when my hair is straight.
Yeah. You recently trended on social media because of an interaction you had with a fan or a critic who called you a hobo because you wore your hair natural. Now, I think every natural head girl in South Africa has had this experience. I certainly have, where you get called names for wearing your hair this way. Take us through that whole occurrence on Twitter.
You know, that was one of the most unfortunate yet beautiful things that could happen, because I don't know what that girl was thinking when she started out. She decided to tweet, let's discuss Florence Masebe's hair. Batunking, hobo look. And I said, ooh, good morning, please, how can I help you?
Yeah.
And she proceeded to tell me how I don't love myself. Hmm. I look like I don't even bath. I need to learn to do something. She says, for goodness sake, we all rock and love our natural hair, but your case is really just terrible. So she psychoanalyzed me and finished it all. And basically in her head, I was this hobo and I was bothering her. Instead of enjoying the work I was doing during that series,
right.
She got bothered with my hair. And I just thought, actually, I hear this every day, so I'm going to make you the example that gets everybody else to shut up. Then, you know.
There's the tweet right there.
There we go.
You said, I'm curious to find out what... Da, 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 and those who choose to get bothered by my hair think my hair should look like.
I'm still curious even today, because when you have a problem with hair that's growing out of somebody else's head, what's so wrong with your life?
Yeah. Very interesting that came up in a conversation we were having earlier. When you said to me, why are people... Because the language that people use around certain issues just betrays a lot of what they're thinking. So why are people still saying, why are you wearing your hair? Why are you wearing natural hair?
You know,
is it something you put on?
I get complimented for wearing my hair naturally. I don't wear it. I don't pick it at a salon. It didn't come out of a catalogue. It's just the hair that grows out every day. I didn't pick for it to grow the way it does. This is the only hair I have.
Absolutely.
And it's not a wig, so I'm not wearing it.
Wow, wow. That's absolutely accurate. Thank you so much for joining us, but you're not leaving. We're going to make you something special that Ayyanda's up to in the kitchen.
All right, well, thank you very much to Bonnie and Florence, and what a beautiful conversation that they are having. And you can join me on the conversation as well on social media. It's Afternoon Chat on Twitter, and then, of course, Afternoon Express on Facebook. So the question for this afternoon is very simple. Why do you wear the hair, your hair, the way that you do? And please do send us a picture and join in on the conversation. And then Lily, Florence's hair game is on another level. And I tell you what, it is a great level. Each and every single one of us probably do have a story we could probably share about our hair. As they say, the hair is the crown. And it could either be your crowning glory or it could be the hair that gives you a frown. Depends on how you look at it. Join us once more. The conversation is happening on social media. When we do come back after the break, though, I will be in the kitchen heating things up, getting that kitchen lit with a steak, and Ayyanda Dlamini is going to give us all those details. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. My name is Ayyanda Dlamini. Happy to be guest presenting with you guys this afternoon. So we're back in the kitchen, and I did say it's probably going to be a bit of a meaty situation. I don't have no beef with you, though, Ayyanda Dlamini. He's the Woolworths product developer. So we are doing meat. What exactly are we doing today?
So as I alluded to earlier on, we are cooking the perfect steak today. I mean, the first thing you've got to think about before actually cooking the perfect steak is to first think what cuts you're after. You've got three great cuts which you could use. You've got a ribeye, you've got a sirloin, and a rump. Mm-hmm. You've got all three cuts eat differently. But before we even start, let's maybe, if you could just brush our steak here with a little bit of olive oil. We've got extra virgin olive oil, which we'll be brushing it with. I know it looks green, but it is extra virgin olive oil. Just be generous, hey, don't be shy.
Oh, okay. No. I love a bit of shine.
So you've got to realize that all three steaks cook differently. I mean, the muscles which move the most are obviously going to be a bit chewier and take a longer time to sort of cook. So today, the cut which we're going to be going for is the sirloin. It is a little bit chewier than the ribeye, because the ribeye hardly moves as compared to the sirloin and the rump, which do a lot of moving on the cow.
Okay, so I have a question for you. When we talk sirloin and you get to a restaurant and people are like, okay, so would you like it medium rare or cooked well done? I've never known. I'll just go medium rare. It sounds good.
That's the right choice. Don't worry. Don't ever ask for it well done. The chefs will come laughing at you. Cool. So you can see we've got this wonderful cap of fat here on the meat, which is what you look for before actually cooking your steak. That fat there actually is flavor. You can see here, the fat looks yellow. Some people might be a little bit scared of it, but don't be scared of it at all. The only reason why it is yellow is because the meat has been matured for a longer time to actually create that flavor.
Okay.
So we can actually, you can see we're smoking here. We're smoking
a
lot.
It's hot.
So what we're going to do is, it's just been extra virgin olive oil. Now we'll be a generous sprinkling of salt and pepper. I always use Maldon salt. The Maldon sort of like draws into the meat much quicker.
So here's my question to you. All we've used right now is a bit of salt and pepper. Now, when I was growing up and a little bit in my kitchen, when I do try to explore with the cooking, you know, you find your steak and chops, your spice,
You can go for that. I just don't like complicating a steak when you do it. I mean, the steak already has been matured. Our free-range steak, the one which you are cooking now, has been matured for 35 days. No steak, you should always ask the butcher another important question. How long has the steak been matured for? Okay. If he tells you 21 days, if he tells you less than 21 days, you better turn around and come to Woolies. Because all of our steaks, it has to be matured for a minimum of 21 days. Okay. Our free-range steak, though, we take the extra level to 35 days. So that's why you've got that beautiful yellow fat on the meat as well.
So here's my question. It's sizzling. It's smelling absolutely gorgeous, by the way. When do we flip it?
You forget about it. You walk around, forget about the steak for a little. You don't want to move the steak too much, because if you move the steak, it's going to start boiling in its own liquid. Because what it's doing now is the juices want to release, but because the pan is so hot, actually shooting back into the pan. So it's actually holding and keeping all those juices inside there. Okay. The perfect, I mean, there's no real time that's set in gospel that, hey, we've got to do it 2-3 minutes aside. What I like doing is you forget about it for a little bit, you look at it. If the steak can turn around with ease, you know you're there. If you're still struggling, that means that leave it there for a little bit longer.
Okay. So here's another quick question. So while cooking, do we still put things like salt and pepper?
That's what I'm going to do now. So I'll put salt on the one side.
Yes.
Now we'll put salt on the other side, so for when we do turn it over. Another trick as well, you don't want to turn the steak over about 3 or 4 times. You cook it on the one side, cook it on the other side, cook it on the fat, just to render the fat down a little bit. So, I mean, just because we will be pressed with time, I'll turn this one around. You can see how beautiful that looks.
Ooh, that's looking good.
And you can see as well on the fat, you're getting that crispiness on the fats. And that's all the flavor that's been developed over the maturing stage of the steak.
Okay, so for those who are scared of the rare situation, it's too red. So is it a matter of keeping it on for a bit longer?
Okay. You keep it on a bit longer on each side. I mean, if you want it red, some people tell you that the steak is still running. I mean, that's your preference. I mean, I would say about 3 minutes minimum if you want to get it past that rare state.
Okay.
But don't cook your steak for more than 5 minutes aside. You're going into the well done and boot leather, as chefs would call it.
And also, that's what I was going to say, you know, avoiding the whole chewy situation where you're fighting with a toothpick at the end. All right, so not too long.
I mean, there's so much time that's been put into actually making the steak eat the way it does. You don't want to mess it up or anything. One couple of minutes on each side and you're done. So what I'm going to do now is just leave it on the fat side like that. And we sort of forget about it. The fat's going to crispen up and release all those juices. The flavor in this whole steak lies in the fat. You can also see as well here actually on top, not that the camera will probably see it, but you and I can see it better.
Yes.
There's a lot of fat or some marbling, which is what it's called. You see the fat running through the meat. That's good for the meat. That means that as the meat is cooking, that's going to release that fat and actually start sizzling up the steak even more.
Now, I love how you've fallen in love with the fat, but a lot of people are scared of fat on the meat. What you got to say to them?
So if you are scared of the fat, I would say leave the fats on during the cooking process because it actually helps with keeping the juices of the meat and actually developing the flavor on the meat. After cooking the steak, you can always trim the fat. A lot of people do that. They'll trim the fat off completely and slice it into small little slices or into medallions. But I would suggest you keep the fat during the cooking process because that's where the flavor lies. You can always remove it afterwards.
Okay, well, I'm loving each and every single bit of it. It looks pretty simple. We didn't use too much, so it looks like it's something that we can definitely get used to in the kitchen. So it's pretty simple. If you also want to get involved and find out some more information, whether it be you want to get a link to the recipe, a list of the ingredients, SMS steak to 33650 and you'll get all those details. Florence is still with us in the studio. She's absolutely gorgeous, so no stranger to television. Let's find out what Bonnie and Florence are getting up to right now.
Welcome back. We're still on the couch with the amazing Florence Masebe, and our conversation has been riveting, to say the least. Now, Flo, can I make this statement? So when I was growing up in the industry watching you, you were always, for me, in that bracket of the elite it girls. When I was growing up, you know, you guys were always sleek, your nails were always on point, everything was just, you know, it girl right. And over the years, I've seen this evolution of your voice, and you come out and say things where I've said to myself, I didn't see this coming.
Where did that
Has there been
from?
An evolution, and how did it happen?
I'll tell you what, I think in my early days in the industry, I was happy-go-lucky Florence. I was just having so much fun. People loved me. I arrived. You know how in the industry you speak English with the right accent, so you're allowed everywhere. And then if you speak a bit of Afrikaans, you get even further. That's back in the day. And then you get to be allowed in spaces where not every other young person in the industry is allowed in. And you do the good red carpets and you get dressed by the great designers. And as all of this was going on, I was like, hang on. But, you know, rural me is tired of acting because it felt like an
acting in the acting, yeah.
I was acting quite a lot. I was acting off screen. And off screen acting is tiring because I had to get up and choose between the things I love. And you don't have to choose. I had to be that child that stood at parties and events and people are talking and they want langoustines and lobsters and I enjoy all of that stuff. But deep down, I just want to eat a little bit of mashonja, or I want putu and inkomazi, or I want mohodu actually today. And I was in cliques that were not about that. And slowly I was like, actually, I just want me to be me. And I'm going to stop apologizing.
Right.
I'm going to start coming out more as that. But when I realize that not everybody is as comfortable in their own skin as I am, I saw it sort of as maybe my duty, as reluctant as I am, to be role model to any young person and being looked up to. My duty should be to help them be 100% with who they are and what they are.
And what was that pivotal moment that caused this shift? Because it doesn't just happen overnight.
It was happening gradually over the years, but I think, you know, number one, when we were battling to get Ererwani done, because for years, it was being rejected for being a story that's too rural and too traditional. Things like that started bothering me, to say I'm in an industry where we want to tell stories of everything that we are not. And when we have to look and celebrate who we are and tell our stories mm-hmm. ourselves as we come up with excuses. It wasn't somebody else saying our stories are too traditional and rural. It was us as a black people saying these stories are too traditional and rural.
Yeah.
Things like that started making me angrier. And I figured maybe actually I leave everything else and focus on this. So mm-hmm. I was like, I'll be a one-woman crusade for heritage issues. And yes. it will be everything from my hair to you name it, I'm there.
Yeah, and you embody that in every single way. You're so proud of the Tshivenda language, the culture, the heritage, and you've started an organization that aids this and supports this. Tell us about it.
You know, at some point, I sat and realized that people don't know enough about Tshivenda and Bavenda people. And I can't keep having to correct misconceptions and stereotypes. But within my own people, there's very little language of all things cultural, and you have to start teaching the young ones to say, this is the way we must go. And starting the Nyamutenga Heritage Foundation was really about creating a place which
I hope...
What
does that mean, the word?
Nyamutenga is a mother of feathers.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
And I figured, let me create the Nyamutenga Foundation to create a space where it can be a reference point, a place where people go to say, let's check, is this done, is this proper, is this, that's Tshivenda. If I don't have the answers, Lord knows there are enough old people in many villages back home that I can go back to and say, Makuru, was this ever done like this? Is there a reason why we did things like this? Is there a reason why this color sits there, why this embroidery wow. sits like that? Wow. Because we're forgetting all of that. And an opportunity to pass on the skills as well of the traditional crafts women and men that nobody seems too interested in.
Wow. And just one short message to any young person watching out there, whether they're in the industry or not, who's battling to find their voice and doing everything they can to fit in.
So don't do everything you can to fit in, because no matter how hard you try, you will never fit in, because you're not meant to fit into anything. You are already you. Just be.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Flo.
Don't
you go. Ayyanda, over to you, darling.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. And I tell you what, I am absolutely loving the conversation that is happening. It has got the whole of South Africa chatting. And the question that we are asking you for today is, how do you wear your hair on a daily basis? And why do you wear it the way you do? At Afternoon Chats on social media, that is Twitter, and then, of course, Afternoon Express on Facebook. And some of you have posted those pics as well. Please do. Margot Fortune says, I wear my hair like this because it's what I can maintain and makes me feel confident. And why not, Margot? And then Liketeng Dlovu says, I love my natural and I don't bother who says what because it's my style and so in love with it every day. I keep it like that and it's absolutely stress-free and costless. And that's the thing about it. It costs you less just to maintain and keep your own natural hair healthy. When we come back after the break, the conversations continue. Bonnie's on the couch with Professor Dlovu.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express live on SABC3. As we continue our conversation around hair today, we're joined again by Professor Ncoza Dlova, the head of dermatology at the University of KZN, who joined us last time to talk about the harmful effects of skin bleaching. Aside from skin, she's also done extensive research into hair and the damaging effects of certain hair treatments. Welcome back, Professor Dlova. Lovely to have you with us.
Thanks.
Look gorgeous.
Thanks, Moni. So kind.
Now, many of us are not aware that hair loss and just basically hair disorders in black people's hair are caused by both man-made and natural causes. Can you take us through some of the disorders?
Yes, yeah, I think that's an important question that you're asking. And that's the reason why we actually appreciate this opportunity
yeah.
to share our research with the public, because when we publish in journals and textbooks, the consumers do not read that.
It doesn't reach the right ears.
It doesn't reach the right ears, yeah. So firstly, one of the top common conditions that occur in African people is what you see the damage due to hair relaxers. And we call it trichorhexis nodosa, meaning
The pH of the normal skin and hair is about 5.4 to 5.9, but when you use relaxers, the pH is about 12 to 14, and that pH is too high, it's alkaline, it actually damages the hair. So the other thing about African hair is that it is brittle, it's very fragile, and it knots and coils. In fact, it's one thing that I know that actually does not stick to gravity. You know, whatever you do with black hair, it just shrinks down.
Right, yeah. Right.
So this, what you see on the screen here, is a lady who's been using relaxers for a long time. And you can see the hair is broken down on the shafts and it's not equal. And all the other hair around it's so big, you can just pull it and it breaks off like that. So that's one, okay. one of the commonest, top one. And the second one is traction alopecia. We call it injibaba. Yes, injibaba.
At a stadium.
Yep. Now, what you're seeing here, it's a young lady. Can you see how tight the skin is?
It's from pulling the
hair
repeatedly.
It's from pulling the hair. And you can see there's erythema, redness around the hair, and also some red pimple-like follicles. Now, that is a sign that you are actually causing damage to the hair. So chronic pulling, repeated pulling, pulls the hair out of the hair follicle, and it falls. So this is the early stage. In fact, no person, no African or black person should experience pain or tension when their hair is being done.
Yeah.
You should literally tell your hairstylist, no, this is too tight, don't do it, and they must redo it. But sometimes they don't understand and they're stubborn, but we need to affirm ourselves and say it shouldn't be like that. Yeah.
Well, that's quite a paradigm shift, right? Because when I was younger and I used to get taken to the hair salon to get my hair relaxed, they say to you, "Ushele makshisa." But by then you're burning, your hair's burning. What I just said is, tell us when your hair starts burning or your scalp starts burning. So there is this belief that looking beautiful or doing any kind of hair treatment should hurt, and it's only working when it's hurting. How do we fix that?
Yeah, I think we need to dispel, it's a myth. You know, we have to dispel those myths, hence we are here.
Right.
In fact, by the time you feel the burning, as you say, it's too late, it's penetrated the skin and it's going to cause contact dermatitis, inflammation, and eventually the hair falls off. When you see the hair is shiny, when the scalp is shiny, it's gone, permanent, can't do
permanently
anything.
Permanently gone.
You cannot reverse that
right.
hair loss. Yeah.
And what do we have here?
Here we have a condition, well, this is not man-made.
This
is a natural condition. It's called a central centrifugal cicatricial alopecia. I know it's a bit hectic to say that word, But basically, it's a skin, it's a hair condition that is exclusively seen in African patients, mainly women, and it tends to occur on this area and it spreads centrally like that.
Okay.
Now, it's seen in people with curly hair. We described a family there in South Africa, and we observed that it's genetic, you know, but you still need to do further studies. But what is interesting about this condition is that once your doctor has diagnosed it, or if your hairstylist has observed it, you should try and keep your hair as natural as possible. No relaxing, no chemicals, no traction, no braids, no weaving, and no hair extensions. Because we observed that if you have all of these environmental factors, there is rapid progression of the condition, becomes worse faster. And I think a study that was done here by Prof Kumal as well showed that if people braid or pull relaxed hair, there's a high prevalence of hair loss.
Wow. So what about somebody watching and hairdressers saying, but you're showing us examples of people who are not using relaxers properly, who've left it on for too long, or they didn't wash it out properly. That's not how my relaxer looks. Is there a situation where you can use a relaxer for a long period of time and it doesn't damage your hair?
Is that impossible? That does not exist. Relaxers, by their nature, they damage the hair because our hair is very fragile and kinky. Of course, we do admit African hair is curly, it's kinky, it's very difficult to manage. So people use relaxers to try and make it manageable. But we need to embrace our hair, keep your hair short. You can still have twists. Twists are the less damaging to the hair. If you have twists or amagoda or one, but make sure that they don't pull your skin, you can still maintain a nice afro. But relaxers are definitely not good for our hair.
Wow, thank you so much for joining us today. Ayyanda.
Well, I tell you what, if you are leaving the hair salon on a Saturday morning looking like you got a free facelift, girl, then we have a serious problem. We've heard from the professor. Too tight is definitely not right. Join us with the conversation that we are having this afternoon. How is it that you wear your hair and why do you? And please do send us a picture. Afternoon Chat on Twitter and then Afternoon Express on Facebook. Let's have a look and see. Tunde Gankomose says, people will always have opinions about others' hair. I have Afro and I am proud of my natural hair. You can't say I wear hair when I've got natural hair, but natural, it means it grows naturally without using anything. Got a point there. And then Khumonso Pokombe, loving the guest presenter. Thank you. Love you too. Thanks for connecting. And she says, that's how I prefer to wear my hair, short and bob cut. And then Caroline Mameja, look how you look, Florence. It's a choice to look however you feel. I'm loving the comments that are coming in. Keep going with the conversation. When we come back after the break, wondered why our sisters and brothers stand outside the swimming pool? Chances are we don't want to get our hair wet. We help you out with that after the break. Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. Now, the hair issue has been paramount in the loft today, and we've had very interesting discussions about it. And while the debate is going on around South Africa, Nomvuyo Treffers, a mother and entrepreneur, found a related issue that presented itself. Her daughters would ask her to play splash in the pool, but she was always hesitant to get her hair wet. She tried looking for swimming caps, but found that even the large sizes only covered half her hair. It didn't make sense that in a country where the majority of people have afros, braids, dreadlocks, etc., there wasn't a swimming cap that fits. So she made one and it's called the SWIMMA. Welcome, Nomvuyo. Welcome to the loft.
Thank
Lovely
you
to really have
much.
You with us.
Thank you.
What a brilliant idea. And most of the most brilliant ideas are always simple, right?
Yes.
So what inspired this?
Well, as you mentioned, I have children and because growing up, getting wet and in the swimming pools, because I grew up in a township where there were no swimming pools. And when I had children, there were pools and they learned to swim. So they asked me, Mom, can you swim with us? And I would oblige, and I knew it would be hours of my hair taking, like, to dry. And eventually I would say, try and get out of it by saying, I'll sit and watch you. And so yeah. It wasn't right because they're growing and one day they will, I won't be a cool mom. They
right.
will want in the pool with them.
So. And you will have missed out on all those years
yes.
that you could have had fun with them in the pool, right?
Yes.
So
definitely.
Initially you were just making these for yourself and your daughters. What made you decide to widen it and make it a big business idea?
Because I thought I can't be the only, looking around South Africa and everyone that looks like me, that have the hair like mine and bigger and all of that. So I thought it's not my,
I'm not the only one with the problem
in this country that has that problem. There are millions out there that need it as
well. And how's it different from other caps?
This one actually accommodates quite a volume of hair, large. Mm-hmm. It can accommodate a big afro, it can weave, braids, dreadlocks, and which is the style that I have currently. So we also, I mean, it took a while to get to this. It didn't just happen in a week or anything like that.
Right.
It was a lot of investigation and...
Lots of research.
Yes, and processes to get to this point.
Yeah. And what was the response from clients, from retailers, when you first presented this idea?
Yeah, it's been overwhelming. South Africa, the male, I'm currently receiving on social media everywhere.
Wow.
They say they've waited this all their lives, and I've been sending... orders over, like, all over South Africa already.
That's amazing.
So yeah.
Where are the caps available?
They are available online. You can order online, but we are the ones that are in Cape Town can go to Cape Town for such. So,
yeah.
But we Korean, like, Gauteng, they've gone, and there's the order from Botswana, there's in everywhere,
yeah.
Durban.
How important do you think, generally, it is for hair like ours to be represented commercially in retail stores, in public schools, in just spaces where we exist?
I think it's really important. I mean, we have this hair, and also, I mean, because at one point I know, because with my children, I actually ended up cutting my hair, wanting to be a good mother and swim. So
yeah.
I think it's very, very important because you can have your hair, have the hairstyle that you want and still swim and come out dry.
So you did say that spending time in the pool with your kids presented some challenges before you made the cap.
Yes.
And now that you have this cap, how has your relationship with your kids changed?
It has changed so much. I mean, there's been fun. And for me, getting into the pool now it just liberated me in many ways. And my kids are really happy. And for them, it was not about anything else. It's just having me there.
Yeah. I mean, so. I remember when I was at school and we used to swim. The caps were so sore because they were too tight around my hair, and I had natural hair and I had a little afro. I absolutely love it. I also love your logo.
Yes.
It's a logo of a woman with an afro.
Yes.
Did you design it?
Yes, I did. It represents both like large volume hair and proudly black. So because we have that. Yeah.
Do they come in other colors?
Not at this point, but with all the responses that we've been getting, a lot of
please make some in pink.
Are responding, saying we want more, we want colors.
I want one in pink.
In pink, okay.
Thank you so much. What a brilliant idea.
Thank you so much.
So with the summer season fast approaching, you'll definitely need to get your hands on one of these. And today's your lucky day. We're giving away a set of swimmer caps today to some lucky viewers. To enter, pick up your phone now and SMS the keyword express to 33650. SMSs are charged at R1.50 each. T's and C's apply and can be found on afternoonexpress.co.za.
Bonnie wanting a pink cap, only she would. I'm loving those swimmer caps. I tell you what, it's going to get rid of some of those plastic bags on the heads on the beaches we see in December. So we're carrying on our conversation for today at Afternoon Chat on Twitter, Afternoon Express on Facebook. Tande Gangomose, this is my natural hair. Since 2012, I've been rocking it the way I want. I'm proud of my hair. Lesedi Kwene says, I feel more beautiful and confident with my short hair. And then Sam Sombiti says, as an African, I love to keep my hair neat and spongy, and so do I. So when we come back after the break, I am back in the kitchen. We're going to finish up that meal. It's very meaty and tasty. Express yourself. Express yourself. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Ayyanda Dlamini, guest presenting this afternoon, and I'm back in the kitchen with Anda. So Anda, let's get straight to it. We've been we've been cooking up the steak.
Yes, that's
it
great.
Is done. It's good.
Steak is done. Mm-hmm. Let's see what we're going to pair the steak with now.
Okay.
Beautiful pesto just to top the steak off. So you can use any soft herbs you'd like here. Yeah? Today we'll be going with Italian parsley. You could use your coriander.
Okay.
So we're going to chuck all of that inside here. Let me just tear it. Mm-hmm. Ooh, let me not make too much of a mess.
Okay, what do you want me to do on the side?
You could actually start cutting that lemon for me in half.
All right.
I won't use all of this.
That should
I can
be
see
good.
It's a lot.
That's pretty
simple. So pesto,
enough.
Typically you'll add your herbs first. You'll always have some sort of nuts. Today mm-hmm. we're using almonds. These are blanched almonds from Woody's, already blanched for you. All we've done is just toasted them. Then we'll take also from the lemon, we've got lemon zest, which we're adding just for flavor. Mm-hmm. We've got garlic, which has also been chopped up very finely there for us. We'll take the lemon, which you've sliced, just squeeze a little bit of lemon juice mm-hmm. there.
All right.
And then just to finish it off, the olive oil.
Okay.
Be generous with that. That is what makes the pesto, the olive oil and the juice from the...
And of course the taste as well.
So you can just blend that.
Okay, it looks pretty straightforward, very simple enough.
And a pesto should always, mm-hmm. I mean, you don't have to be very fine with the pesto. Pesto is there to be rustic, you know, so it doesn't have to be completely fine. Mm-hmm. Let's just pull that one a little bit more.
Okay. I love the smell already.
You can get
the basil, the lemon.
The lemon, and you get the olive oil as well.
Okay.
So we're gonna plate now. What we're going to do is, I'll take the steak and I'll just slice it up into... slices for you.
Okay.
You could slice it anywhere you want.
Well, that's it.
Mm-hmm. So you can see, cooked beautifully.
Oh,
as you can see, a wonderful piece there.
Goodness. All right. Oh, man, that looks juicy.
Don't chow it yet.
Well, this is my piece for later on. Put it in the corner. Thank you very
so you
much.
Can see,
okay.
I'll just leave that piece like that mm-hmm. there.
You and can of course, slice the other one as well. Presentation always good.
So
right?
Today, when you're serving sort of platters like this for a couple of people, presentation mm-hmm. is very key, but it doesn't have to be fine dining.
All right.
So we're going to go with. We're just going to play around and see how that
okay.
goes.
Okay, that's great because always get your fingers dirty. It makes things extra delicious. We've got some tomatoes and some more leaves. What's going on this side?
You could actually just place some tomatoes and place some leaves there for me.
Yeah,
I'll start getting to this pesto.
All right.
So all rustic. Remember what I said? Nothing needs to be perfect.
Oh yes. Oh yes. All right. Just spreading it
that's
out.
Fine.
And some of the leaves as
take
well.
Take some of the leaves. Place them there.
Is still
well.
My basil here?
That's correct. Yeah, okay. With basil. Yeah, just tear it. Don't be shy. Oh,
don't be shy. All right, I'm not going to be shy.
We can just drop it on there top go. There. Okay. Okay, cool. We've got the there cheese just to finish it off. I'll start finishing off the steak with the pesto.
All right, it's looking like a blob. What's going on?
So this is buffalo mozzarella. It comes in a big round chunk. You've just got to tear it up. Just be rustic about it again.
Well, this is the great thing about cooking and what I've learned in the kitchen at Afternoon Express is that actually we don't have to be so gentle. We can just roughen things up a little bit.
Exactly.
Add to the flavor.
We're not in a restaurant or anything, so rustic. I love rustic food.
No. Okay. You can see. Loving
look
this.
At how beautiful that pesto looks.
Oh, that looks amazing. My goodness. Okay.
And just to finish your salad off there, I mean, it is done. We can leave it like that. Top it off. Maybe just.
Where's my good old cloth? All right.
I don't have a cloth for you right now, sorry.
Okay. Well, I'm taking
if I had if I had a clean spoon, I would just drizzle a little bit of olive oil on there.
Okay, lovely.
But we can do
absolutely
that.
Absolutely gorgeous.
And there you go.
And there you go. So simple it is. And it's so simple for you too at home. If you want to join us in the kitchen, get involved. It is so easy. To get the list of the ingredients and the recipe, SMS the keyword, and that keyword is steak, to 33650. And then, of course, if you've missed any of this, you want to make sure you got it for tonight, here is the recap. Welcome back. It's about that time.
We get to sample your dish, girl.
Well,
what is it?
Thank you. Well, we are having a sirloin with some basil pesto. Mm-hmm. And it's looking all very colourful and delicious. Enjoy it, please.
Wow. And that shade you threw at the ladies who wear plastic on their heads.
Look, can we please just say the... But honestly, you relate to it, don't you?
What is that about?
All I'm saying is let's save the environment and save our hair at the same time. Aren't
it? Yeah.
It definitely is. Yeah. Florence, so inspired by you today, honestly. And Bonnie, you're right. You know, as we're growing up and coming up in the industry, trying to figure out the hair thing has always been a big thing.
Yeah, because it's an identity thing.
It is an identity thing.
Bigger picture is an identity thing. Our kids are starting, you know, they're braiding kids at a very young age. So the traction now, orange jeeps, we're not seeing it at 40, 50, we're seeing it 18 years old.
Oh, dear.
You know?
Yes.
Because this, we're braiding and weaving and putting all these heavy things on the children. So that really needs
to... The biggest message we need to be telling people is please just let black hair be.
Wow.
Because when you just let your hair be, you're not going to be pulling it and causing the traction alopecia and all these other damaging things that we do to it.
Yeah.
Just let it be.
I mean, look how beautiful. You're all natural.
Absolutely. Natural. Yes.
Florence, in fact, Florence, what can we expect from you coming up? Movies? What are you producing? What are you working on?
I have a script that must get finished. That I'm missing deadlines and missing deadlines, but I'm producing another film in Venda. I'm very excited about it. I might appear in it because I'm not finding somebody to play one character. But Furumu Gowani, who played Ayyanda.
Yes, she's amazing.
She's amazing,
incredible.
Very, very talented young girl. Here's my thing. I don't think people will write many vendor roles for me to play, so I have to write as many vendor roles for as many vendor actresses and actors as possible.
That's awesome.
Sure.
And yourself, Professor, just your work around bringing awareness, do you find that people are becoming more and more aware and understand what they're doing to their skins and their hair?
Yeah, sure, because I think what was also a realization for me is that we think people out there know what the problems are. They don't know.
They don't.
They don't know. And once we educate them and inform them, they actually appreciate it and they change their ways of doing things. And what we're planning to do now is to, we are in discussion with the Department of Education and Department of Health, and we're going to introduce skin and hair care at a young age during their life orientation program.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this goes for both black and white kids because the skin cancer, the sun tanning, damaging the skin and causing skin cancer, they don't know about those things.
Right.
So I think it's our responsibility as scientists and academics to plant the seed at an early stage.
Yeah,
and that's
what
I'm actually working on right now.
And we
now.
Just need to say to parents, just leave the child's hair, just let it be. As long as it's clean and it's neat, just let stop blowing out your child's hair.
Blow out.
You're gonna blow out.
And I think you're right, because as parents, we're trying to manage the situation.
Yeah.
But actually, in trying to manage the situation, we are actually missing.
Because we're forgetting that it doesn't need to be managed. It doesn't need to be controlled.
It's not a situation.
It doesn't need to be. It's not a problem.
Ooh, I need to change my language.
We don't need to be solving black hair. And it's not a dilemma.
Yes. I'm at school today.
You are school today. And okay. I must tell you, the weaves, you know, in the last 5 or 7 years, we didn't see so many problems. We literally have
15 seconds to go.
Oh, my goodness.
We've got to get this in. Thank you so much for joining us. See you tomorrow, same time, same place. Thank you so much for joining us, girl.
We love you.
Happy eating.
Another feel-good production.